This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The space race was a 20th century competition between two Cold War rivals, the Soviet Union USSR and the United States US, for supremacy in spaceflight capability. It had its origins in the missile-based nuclear arms race between the two nations that occurred following World War. A Soviet cosmonaut crew. The end of the space race is harder to pinpoint than its beginning, but it was over by the December 1991 dissolution of the Soviet Union, after which true spaceflight cooperation between the US and Russia began. The space race has left a legacy of Earth communications and weather satellites, and continuing human space presence on the International Space Station. It has also sparked increases in spending on education and research and development, which led to beneficial spin-off technologies. Contents: 1. Early rocket development. 11. World War II Germany. 12. Soviet rocket development. 13. American rocket development. 14. Cold War missile race. 2. The race to space begins. 21. First artificial satellite. 22. U.S. reaction. 3. Unmanned lunar probes. 4. First human in space. 5. First American in space. 6. Kennedy directs the race toward the moon. 7. Completion of Vostok and Mercury programs. 71. Mercury 72. Vostok 8. Kennedy proposes a joint US-USSR program. 9. Gemini and Voskhod 91. Voskhod program 92. Project Gemini 10. Soviet manned moon programs. 11. Outer space treaty. 12. Disaster strikes both sides. 13. Onward to the moon. 14. Apollo 11. 15. The race wins down. 151. Salyuts and Skylab 152. Apollo-Soyuz test project. 16. Legacy. 161. Human spaceflight after Apollo 17. See also. 18. Notes. 19. References. 20. External links. Early rocket development. World War II Germany. Werner von Braun 1912-1977, technical director of Nazi Germany's missile program, became the United States' lead rocket engineer during the 1950s and 1960s. The space race can trace its origins to Germany, beginning in the 1930s and continuing during World War. Prodigy was recruited by Becker and Dornberger to join their secret army program at Kummersdorf West in 1932. Von Braun dreamed of conquering outer space with rockets, and did not initially see the military value in missile technology during the Second World War. General Dornberger was the military head of the Army's rocket program, Zanson became the commandant of the Peenemünde Army Rocket Center, and von Braun was the technical director of the ballistic missile program. They led the team that built the Aggregat 4A4 rocket, which became the first vehicle to reach outer space during its test flight program in 1942 and 1943. By 1943, Germany began mass producing the A4 as the Vergeltungswaffe 2 vengeance weapon 2, or more commonly, V2, a ballistic missile with a 320 km 200. Recruiting von Braun and most of his engineering team, who later helped develop the American missile and space exploration programs. The United States also acquired a large number of complete V-2 rockets. Soviet rocket development. Further information: Soviet rocketry chief designer Sergei Korolyov left, with the father of the Soviet atomic bomb Igor Kurchatov, and chief theoretician Mstislav Keldysh in 1956. The German Rocket Center in Peenemünde was located in the eastern part of Germany, which became the Soviet zone of occupation on Stalin's orders. The Soviet Union sent its best rocket engineers to this region to see what they could salvage for future weapons systems. The Soviet rocket engineers were led by Sergei Korolyov. He had been involved in space clubs and early Soviet rocket design in the 1930s, but was arrested in 1938 during Joseph Stalin's Great Purge and imprisoned for 6 years in Gulag. After the war, he became the USSR's chief rocket and spacecraft engineer, essentially the Soviet counterpart to von Braun. His identity was kept a state secret throughout the Cold War, and he was identified publicly only as the chief designer. In the West, his name was only officially revealed when he died in 1966 after almost a year in the area around Peenemünde. Soviet officials moved most of the captured German rocket specialists to Gorodomlya Island on Lake Seliger, about 240 km 150. program of launching them and instructing American engineers in their operation. These tests led to the first rocket to take photos from outer space, and the first two-stage rocket, the WAC Corporal V-2 combination. In 1949, the German rocket team was moved from Fort Bliss to the Army's new Redstone Arsenal, located in Huntsville, Alabama. In 1950, from here, von Braun and his team developed the Army's first operational medium-range ballistic missile, the Redstone rocket, that in slightly modified versions, launched both America's first satellite, and the first piloted Mercury space missions. It became the basis for both the Jupiter and Saturn family of rockets. Cold War missile race. The Cold War would become the great engine, the supreme catalyst, that sent rockets and their cargoes far above Earth and worlds away. If Tsiolkovsky, Oberth, Goddard, and others were the fathers of rocketry, the competition between capitalism and communism was its midwife. William E. Burroughs, This New Ocean, The Other World Series, p. 147. The Cold War 1947-1991 developed between two former allies, the Soviet Union and the United States. Soon after the end of the Second World War, it involved a continuing state of political conflict, military tension, proxy wars, and economic competition, primarily between the Soviet Union and its satellite states, often referred to as the Eastern Bloc, and the powers of the Western world, particularly the United States. The primary participants' military forces never clashed directly, but expressed this conflict through military coalitions, strategic conventional force deployments, extensive aid to states deemed vulnerable, proxy wars, espionage, propaganda, a nuclear arms race, and economic and technological competitions, such as the space race. In simple terms, the Cold War could be viewed as an expression of the ideological struggle between communism and capitalism. The United States faced a new uncertainty beginning in September 1949, when it lost its monopoly on the atomic bomb. American intelligence agencies discovered that the Soviet Union had exploded its first atomic bomb, with the consequence that the United States potentially could face a future nuclear war that, for the first time, might devastate its cities. Given this new danger, the United States participated in an arms race with the Soviet Union that included development of the hydrogen bomb, as well as intercontinental strategic bombers and intercontinental ballistic missiles, ICBMs, capable of delivering nuclear weapons. A new fear of communism and its sympathizers swept the United States during the 1950s, which devolved into paranoid McCarthyism, with communism spreading in China, Korea, and Eastern Europe. Americans came to feel so threatened that popular and political culture condoned extensive witch hunts to expose communist spies. Part of the American reaction to the Soviet atomic and hydrogen bomb tests included maintaining a large air force, under the control of the Strategic Air Command. SAC-SAC employed intercontinental strategic bombers, as well as medium bombers based close to Soviet airspace in Western Europe and in Turkey that were capable of delivering nuclear payloads. For its part, the Soviet Union harbored fears of invasion, having suffered at least 27 million casualties during World War II after being invaded by Nazi Germany in 1941. The Soviet Union was wary of its former ally, the United States, which until late 1940 was the sole possessor of atomic weapons. The United States had used these weapons operationally during World War II, and it could use them again against the Soviet Union, laying waste its cities and military centers, since the Americans had a much larger air force than the Soviet Union, and the United States maintained advance air bases near Soviet territory. In 1947, Stalin ordered the development of intercontinental ballistic missiles, ICBMs, in order to counter the perceived American threat. Soviet R-7 ICBM, and its derivative launch vehicles for Sputnik, Vostok, Voskhod, and Soyuz. In 1953, Korolyov was given the go-ahead to develop the R-7 Semyorka rocket, which represented a major advance from the German design. Although some of its components, notably boosters, still resemble the German G-4, the new rocket incorporated stage design, a completely new control system, and a new fuel. It was successfully tested on August 21, 1957, and became the world's first fully operational ICBM. The following month, it was later used to launch the first satellite into space, and derivatives launched all piloted Soviet spacecraft. The United States had multiple rocket programs divided among the different branches of the American armed services, which meant that each force developed its own ICBM program. The Air Force initiated ICBM research in 1945 with the MX-774. However, its funding was canceled and only three partially successful launches were conducted in 1947. In 1950, von Braun began testing testing the Air Force PGM-11 Redstone rocket family at Cape Canaveral in 1951, the Air Force began a new ICBM program called MX-1593, and by 1955 this program was receiving top priority funding. The MX-1593 program evolved to become the Atlas A, with its maiden launch occurring June 11, 1957, becoming the first successful American ICBM. Its upgraded version, the Atlas D rocket, later served as a nuclear ICBM and as the orbital launch vehicle for Project Mercury and the remote-controlled Agena target vehicle used in Project Gemini, with the Cold War as an engine for change in the ideological competition between the United States and the Soviet Union. A coherent space policy began to take shape in the United States during the late 1950s. Korolev took inspiration from the competition as well, achieving many firsts to counter the possibility that the United States might prevail. The race to space begins. Further information, Soviet space program and space policy of the United States' first artificial satellite in 1955, with both the United States and the Soviet Union building ballistic missiles that could be utilized to launch objects into space. The starting line was drawn for the space race in separate announcements 4 days apart. Both nations publicly announced that they would launch artificial Earth satellites by 1957 or 1958. On July 29, 1955, James C. Hagerty, President Dwight D. Eisenhower's press secretary, announced that the United States intended to launch small Earth-circling satellites between July 1, 1957, and December 31, 1958, as part of their contribution to the International Geophysical Year IGY. 4 days later, at the 6th Congress of International Astronautical Federation in Copenhagen, scientist Leonid Isadov spoke to international reporters at the Soviet embassy, and announced his country's intention to launch a satellite as well, in the near future. On August 30, 1955, Korolev managed to get the Soviet Academy of Sciences to create a commission whose purpose was to beat the Americans into Earth orbit. This was the de facto start date for the space race. The Council of Ministers of the Soviet Union began a policy of treating development of its space program as a classified state secret. Initially, President Eisenhower was worried that a satellite passing above a nation at over 100 kilometers 62. He was concerned that the Soviet Union would accuse the Americans of an illegal overflight, thereby scoring a propaganda victory at his expense. Eisenhower and his advisers believed that a nation's airspace sovereignty did not extend into outer space, acknowledged as the Kármán line, and he used the 1957-58 International Geophysical Year launches to establish this principle in international law. Eisenhower also feared that he might cause an international incident and be called a warmonger if he were to use military missiles as launchers. Therefore, he selected the untried Naval Research Laboratory's Vanguard rocket, which was a research-only booster. This meant that von Braun's team was not allowed to put a satellite into orbit with their Jupiter-C rocket, because of its intended use as a future military vehicle. On September 20, 1956, von Braun and his team did launch a Jupiter-C that was capable of putting a satellite into orbit, but the launch was used only as a suborbital test of nose cone reentry technology. Korolev received word about von Braun's 1956 Jupiter-C test, but thinking it was a satellite mission that failed, he expedited plans to get his own satellite in orbit. Since his R-7 was substantially more powerful than any of the American boosters, he made sure to take full advantage of this capability by designing Object D as his primary satellite. It was given the designation D to distinguish it from other R-7 payload designations A, B, V, and G, which were nuclear weapon payloads. Object D dwarfed the proposed American satellites by having a weight of 1,400 kilograms, 3,100. We're planning to announce a major breakthrough at an International Geophysical Year conference at the National Academy of Sciences in Washington, D.C., with a paper entitled Satellite Over the Planet. On October 6, 1957, Korolev anticipated that von Braun might launch a Jupiter-C with a satellite payload on or around October 4 or 5. In conjunction with the paper, he hastened the launch, moving it to October 4. The launch vehicle for PS-1 was a modified R-7 vehicle 8K71PS No. M1PS without much of the test equipment and radio gear that was present in the previous launches. It arrived at the Soviet missile base Tyre-Atam in September and was prepared for its mission at launch site number 1 on Friday, October 4, 1957, at exactly 10 hours 28 minutes and 34 seconds. U.S. Reaction Main Article, Sputnik Crisis. The Soviet success raised a great deal of concern in the United States. For example, economist Bernard Baruch wrote in an open letter titled The Lessons of Defeat to the New York Herald Tribune, "While we devote our industrial and technological power to producing new model automobiles and more gadgets, the Soviet Union is conquering space. It is Russia, not the United States, who has had the imagination to hitch its wagon to the stars and the skill to reach for the moon and all but grasp it. America is worried it should be." Eisenhower ordered Project Vanguard to move up its timetable and launch its satellite much sooner than originally planned. The December 6, 1957 Project Vanguard launch failure occurred at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station in Florida. Broadcast live in front of a U.S. television audience, it was a monumental failure, exploding a few seconds after launch, and it became an international joke. The satellite appeared in newspapers under the names Flopnik, Staputnik, Kaputnik, and Dudnik in the United Nations. The Russian delegate offered the U.S. representative aid under the Soviet program of technical assistance to backwards nations. Only in the wake of this very public failure did Von Braun's Redstone team get the go-ahead to launch their Jupiter C rocket as soon as they could in Britain, the U.S.'s Western Cold War ally. The reaction was mixed. Some celebrated the fact that the Soviets had reached space first, while others feared the destructive potential that military uses of spacecraft might bring. William Hayward Pickering, James Van Allen, and Wernher von Braun display a full-scale model of Explorer 1 at a Washington, D.C. news conference after confirmation the satellite was in orbit on January 31, 1958, nearly 4 months after the launch of Sputnik 1. Von Braun and the United States successfully launched its first satellite on a four-stage Juno I rocket derived from the U.S. Army's Redstone missile. At Cape Canaveral, the satellite Explorer 1 was 308 pounds 140. On April 2, 1958, President Eisenhower reacted to the Soviet space lead in launching the first satellite, by recommending to the U.S. Congress that a civilian agency be established to direct non-military space activities. Congress, led by Senate Majority Leader Lyndon B. Johnson, responded by passing the National Aeronautics and Space Act, which Eisenhower signed into law on July 29, 1958. This law turned the National Advisory Committee on Aeronautics into the National Aeronautics and Space Administration NASA. It also created a civilian military liaison committee, chaired by the president, responsible for coordinating the nation's civilian and military space programs. On October 21, 1959, Eisenhower approved the transfer of the Army's remaining space-related activities to NASA on July 1, 1960. The Redstone Arsenal became NASA's George C. Marshall Space Flight Center, with von Braun as its first director. Development of the Saturn rocket family, which when mature, gave the U.S. parity with the Soviets in terms of lifting capability, was thus transferred to NASA unmanned lunar probes in 1958. Korolyov upgraded the R-7 to be able to launch a 400-kilogram 880. Impacted the Moon on September 14, 1959. The 2,785-kilogram 614. Take over manual control of his capsule in an emergency by opening an envelope he had in the cabin that contained a code that could be typed into the computer. It was flown in an automatic mode as a precaution. Medical science at that time did not know what would happen to a human in the weightlessness of space. Vostok 1 orbited the Earth for 108 minutes and made its re-entry over the Soviet Union, with Gagarin ejecting from the spacecraft at 7,000 meters 23,000 of Russia. In 2011, it was declared the International Day of Human Space Flight by the United Nations Poyakali. Gagarin's voice problems playing this file C media helped the radio communication between the launch control room and Gagarin included the following dialogue at the moment of rocket launch. Korolyov, preliminary stage intermediate main lift off. We wish you a good flight. Everything is all right. Gagarin, Pohali Poyakali, let's go. Gagarin's informal Poyakali became a historical phrase in the Eastern Bloc, used to refer to the beginning of the human spaceflight era. First American in space, Alan Shepard, the first American in space. 1961, the U.S. Air Force had been developing a program to launch the first man in space, named Man in Space Soonest. This program studied several different types of one-man space vehicles, settling on a ballistic reentry capsule launched on a derivative Atlas missile, and selecting A group of 9 candidate pilots after NASA's creation, the program was transferred over to the civilian agency and renamed Project Mercury on November 26, 1958. NASA selected a new group of astronaut from the Greek for Star Sailor candidates from Navy, Air Force and Marine test pilots, and narrowed this down to a group of 7 for the program. Capsule design and astronaut training began immediately, working toward preliminary suborbital flights on the Redstone missile, followed by orbital flights on the Atlas. Each flight series would first start unmanned, then carry a non-human primate, then finally men. On May 5, 1961, Alan Shepard became the first American in space, launched in a ballistic trajectory on Mercury Redstone 3, in a spacecraft he named Freedom 7. Though he did not achieve orbit like Gagarin, he was the first person to exercise manual control over his spacecraft's attitude and retro rocket firing after his successful return. Shepard was celebrated as a national hero, honored with parades in Washington, New York, and Los Angeles, and received the NASA Distinguished Service Medal from President John F. Kennedy. Kennedy directs the race toward the moon. These are extraordinary times, and we face an extraordinary challenge. Our strength as well as our convictions have imposed upon this nation the role of leader in freedom's cause. If we are to win the battle that is now going on around the world between freedom and tyranny, the dramatic achievements in space which occurred in recent weeks should have made clear to us all, as did the Sputnik in 1957, the impact of this adventure on the minds of men everywhere, who are attempting to make a determination of which road they should take. Now it is time to take longer strides, time for a great new American enterprise, time for this nation to take a clearly leading role in space achievement, which in many ways may hold the key to our future on Earth. Recognizing the head start obtained by the Soviets with their large rocket engines, which gives them many months of lead time, and recognizing the likelihood that they will exploit this lead for some time to come in still more impressive successes, we nevertheless are required to make new efforts on our own. I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind, or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish. John F. Kennedy, Special Message to Congress on Urgent National Needs, May 25, 1961. Before Gagarin's flight, U.S. President John F. Kennedy's support for America's manned space program was lukewarm. Jerome Wiesner of MIT, who served as a science advisor to Presidents Eisenhower and Kennedy, and himself an opponent of manned space exploration, remarked, "If Kennedy could have opted out of a big space program without hurting the country in his judgment, he would have." As late as March 1961, when NASA Administrator James E. Webb submitted a budget request to fund a moon landing before 1970, Kennedy rejected it because it was simply too expensive. Some were surprised by Kennedy's eventual support of NASA and the space program because of how often he had attacked the Eisenhower administration's inefficiency during the election. Gagarin's flight changed this. Now Kennedy sensed the humiliation and fear on the part of the American public over the Soviet lead. Additionally, the Bay of Pigs invasion, planned before his term began but executed during it, was an embarrassment to his administration due to the colossal failure of the American forces looking for something to save political face. He sent a memo dated April 20, 1961, to Vice President Lyndon B. Johnson, asking him to look into the state of America's space program, and into programs that could offer NASA the opportunity to catch up. The two major options at the time seemed to be, either establishment of an Earth orbital space station, or a manned landing on the moon. Johnson in turn consulted with von Braun, who answered Kennedy's questions based on his estimates of U.S. and Soviet rocket lifting capability. Based on this, Johnson responded to Kennedy, concluding that much more was needed to reach a position of leadership, and recommending that the manned moon landing was far enough in the future that the U.S. had a fighting chance to achieve it first. Kennedy ultimately decided to pursue what became the Apollo program, and on May 25 took the opportunity to ask for congressional support in a Cold War speech titled Special Message on Urgent National Needs, full text. Mission completed 3 orbits in the Friendship 7 spacecraft, and splashed down safely in the Atlantic Ocean. After a tense re-entry, due to what falsely appeared from the telemetry data to be a loose heat shield as the first American in orbit, Glenn became a national hero, and received a ticker tape parade in New York City, reminiscent of that given for Charles Lindbergh on February 23, 1962. President Kennedy escorted him in a parade at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, where he awarded Glenn with the NASA Service Medal. The United United States launched three more Mercury flights after Glenn's. Aurora 7 on May 24, 1962 duplicated Glenn's three orbits, Sigma 7 on October 3, 1962, six orbits, and Faith 7 on May 15, 1963, 22 orbits 324 hours, the maximum capability of the spacecraft. NASA at first intended to launch one more mission, extending the spacecraft's endurance to 3 days, but since this would not beat the Soviet record, it was decided instead to concentrate on developing Project Gemini. Vostok replica of the Vostok capsule. German Titov became the first Soviet cosmonaut to exercise manual control of his Vostok 2 craft on August 6, 1961. The Soviet Union demonstrated 24-hour launch pad turnaround and the capability to launch two piloted spacecraft, Vostok 3 and Vostok 4, in essentially identical orbits. On August 11 and 12, 1962, the two spacecraft came within approximately 65 kilometers 40. The July 1961 Tushino Air Show, mounted on its launch vehicle's third stage, with the nose cone in place, a tail section with eight fins was also added. In an apparent attempt to confuse Western observers, this spurious tail section also appeared on official commemorative stamps and a documentary. Kennedy proposes a joint US-USSR program on September 20, 1963. In a speech before the United Nations General Assembly, President Kennedy proposed that the United States and the Soviet Union join forces in their efforts to reach the moon. Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev initially rejected Kennedy's proposal on October 2, 1997. It was reported that Khrushchev's son Sergei claimed Khrushchev was poised to accept Kennedy's proposal at the time of Kennedy's assassination on November 22, 1963. During the next few weeks, he reportedly concluded that both nations might realize cost benefits and technological gains from a joint venture, and decided to accept Kennedy's offer based on a measure of rapport during their years as leaders of the world's two superpowers, but changed his mind and dropped the idea since he did not have the same trust for Kennedy's successor, Lyndon Johnson, as president. Johnson steadfastly pursued the Gemini and Apollo programs, promoting them as Kennedy's legacy to the American public. 1 week after Kennedy's death, he issued an executive order renaming the Cape Canaveral and Apollo launch facilities after Kennedy. Gemini and Voskhod focused by the commitment to a moon landing. In January 1962, the U.S. announced Project Gemini, a two-man spacecraft that would support the later three-man Apollo by developing the key spaceflight technologies of space rendezvous and docking of two craft, flight durations of sufficient length to simulate going to the moon and back, and extra-vehicular activity to accomplish useful work outside the spacecraft. Meanwhile, Korolyov had planned further, long-term missions for the Vostok spacecraft, and had four Vostoks in various stages of fabrication in late 1963 at his OKB-1 facilities. At that time, the Americans announced their ambitious plans for the Project Gemini flight schedule. These plans included major advancements in spacecraft capabilities, including a two-person spacecraft, the ability to change orbits, the capacity to perform an extravehicular activity EVA, and the goal of docking with another spacecraft. These represented major advances over the previous Mercury or Vostok capsules, and Korolyov felt the need to try to beat the Americans to many of these innovations. Korolyov already had begun designing the Vostok's replacement, the next-generation Soyuz spacecraft, a multi-cosmonaut spacecraft that had at least the same capabilities as the Gemini spacecraft. Soyuz would not be available for at least 3 years, and it could not be called upon to deal with this new American challenge in 1964 or 1965. Political pressure in early 1964, which some sources claim was from Khrushchev while other sources claim was from other Communist Party officials, pushed him to modify his four remaining Vostoks to beat the Americans to new space firsts in the size of flight crews, and the duration of missions. Voskhod program. Main article, Voskhod program. The Voskhod 1 and 2 space capsules. The greater advances of the Soviet space program at the time allowed their space program to achieve other significant firsts, including the first EVA spacewalk and the first mission performed by a crew in shirt sleeves. Gemini took a year longer than planned to accomplish its first flight, allowing the Soviets to achieve another first, launching Voskhod 1 on October 12, 1964, the first spacecraft with a three-cosmonaut crew. The USSR touted another technological achievement during this mission. It was the first space flight during which cosmonauts performed in a shirt-sleeve environment. However, flying without spacesuits was not due to safety improvements in the Soviet spacecraft's environmental systems. Rather, this innovation was accomplished because the craft's limited cabin space space did not allow for spacesuits flying without spacesuits exposed the cosmonauts to significant risk in the event of potentially fatal cabin depressurization. This feat was not repeated until the U.S. Apollo Command Module flew in 1968. This later mission was designed from the outset to safely transport three astronauts in a shirt-sleeve environment while in space between October 14-16, 1964, Leonid Brezhnev and a small cadre of high-ranking Communist Party officials, deposed Khrushchev as Soviet government leader a day after Voskhod 1 landed, in what was called the Wednesday Conspiracy. The new political leaders, along with Korolyov, ended the technologically troublesome Voskhod program, cancelling Voskhod 3 and 4, which were in the planning stages, and started concentrating on the race to the moon. Voskhod 2 ended up being Korolyov's final achievement before his death on January 14, 1966, as it became the last of the many space firsts that demonstrated the USSR's domination in spacecraft technology during the early 1960s. According to historian Asif Siddiqui, Korolyov accomplishments marked the absolute zenith of the Soviet space program, one never, ever attained since. There was a two-year pause in Soviet-piloted space flights while Voskhod's replacement, the Soyuz spacecraft, was designed and developed on March 18, 1965, about a week before the first American-piloted Project Gemini space flight. The USSR accelerated the competition, by launching the two-cosmonaut Voskhod 2 mission with Pavel Belyayev and Alexei Leonov. Voskhod 2's design modifications included the addition of an inflatable airlock to allow for extravehicular activity EVA, also known as a space walk, while keeping the cabin pressurized so that the capsule's electronics would not overheat. Leonov performed the first ever EVA as part of the mission. A fatality was narrowly avoided when Leonov's spacesuit expanded in the vacuum of space, preventing him from re-entering the airlock. In order to overcome this, he had to partially depressurize his spacesuit to a potentially dangerous level. He succeeded in safely re-entering the ship, but he and Belyayev faced further challenges when the spacecraft's atmospheric controls flooded the cabin with 45% pure oxygen, which had to be lowered to acceptable levels before re-entry. The re-entry involved two more challenges: an improperly timed retrorocket firing caused the Voskhod 2 to land 386 kilometers 240. To demonstrate their ability to change their craft's orbit on Gemini, 5 August 1965, astronauts L. Gordon Cooper and Charles Pete Conrad set a record of almost 8 days in space, long enough for a piloted lunar mission on Gemini 6A. December 1965, command pilot Wally Schirra achieved the first space rendezvous with Gemini 7, accurately matching his orbit to that of the other craft, station keeping for three consecutive orbits at distances as close as 1 foot 030. Way, Project Gemini built up spaceflight experience for the pool of astronauts for the Apollo lunar mission's Soviet manned moon program's main article, Soviet manned lunar program Soyuz 7KL3 Luny Orbitalny Korabl, alongside the Apollo Command Service Module to scale LK lunar lander Luny Korabl, alongside the Apollo lunar module to scale Korolyov's design bureau produced two prospectuses for circumlunar spaceflight March 1962 and May 1963, the main space craft for which were early versions of his Soyuz design. Soviet Communist Party Central Committee Command 655-268 officially established two secret, competing manned programs for circumlunar flights and lunar landings. On August 3, 1964, the circumlunar flights were planned to occur in 1967, and the landings to start in 1968. The circumlunar program Zond, created by Vladimir Chelomey's design bureau OKB-52, was to fly two cosmonauts in a stripped-down Soyuz 7KL-1, launched by Chelomey's Proton R-500 rocket. The Zond sacrificed habitable cabin volume for equipment. By omitting the Soyuz orbital module, Chelomey gained favor with Khrushchev by employing members of his family. Korolyov's lunar landing program was designated N-1 per Liter 3, for its N-1 superbooster and a more advanced Soyuz 7KL-3 spacecraft, also known as the Lunar Orbital Module Luny Orbitalny Korabl, LOK, with a crew of two. A separate lunar lander Luny Korabl, LK, would carry a single cosmonaut to the lunar surface. The N-1 per Liter 3 launch vehicle had three stages to Earth orbit, a fourth stage for Earth departure, and a fifth stage for lunar landing assist. The combined space vehicle was roughly the same height and takeoff mass as the three-stage U.S. Apollo, Saturn V, and exceeded its takeoff thrust by 28%, but had only roughly half the translunar injection payload capability following Khrushchev's ouster from power. Chelomey's Zond program was merged into the N-1 per Liter 3 program Outer Space Treaty, the US and USSR began discussions on the peaceful uses of space as early as 1958, presenting issues for debate to the United Nations, which created a Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space in 1959. On May 10, 1962, Vice President Johnson addressed the Second National Conference on the Peaceful Uses of Space, revealing that the United States and the USSR both supported a resolution passed by the Political Committee of the UN General Assembly on December 1962, which not only urged member nations to extend the rules of international law to outer space, but to also cooperate in its exploration. Following the passing of this resolution, Kennedy commenced his communications proposing a cooperative American-Soviet space program. The UN ultimately created a treaty on principles governing the activities of states in the exploration and use of outer space, including the Moon and other celestial bodies, which was signed by the United States, USSR, and the United Kingdom on January 27, 1967 and went into force the following October 10. Wikisource has original text related to this article, Outer Space Treaty of 1967. This treaty bars party states from placing weapons of mass destruction in Earth orbit, on the Moon, or any other celestial body, exclusively limits the use of the Moon and other celestial bodies to peaceful purposes, and expressly prohibits their use for testing weapons of any kind, conducting military maneuvers, or establishing military bases, installations, and fortifications, declares that the exploration of outer space shall be done to benefit all countries and shall be free for exploration and use by all the states, explicitly forbids any government from claiming a celestial resource such as the Moon or a planet, claiming that they are the common heritage of mankind, not subject to national appropriation by claim of sovereignty, by means of use or occupation, or by any other means. However, the state that launches a space object retains jurisdiction and control over that object, holds any state liable for damages caused by their space object, declares that the activities of non-governmental entities in outer space, including the Moon and other celestial bodies, shall require authorization and continuing supervision by the appropriate state party to the treaty, and states' parties shall bear international responsibility for national space activities whether carried out by governmental or non-governmental entities, and a state party to the treaty which has reason to believe that an activity or experiment planned by another state party in outer space, including the Moon and other celestial bodies, would cause potentially harmful interference with activities in the peaceful exploration and use of outer space, including the Moon and other celestial bodies, may request consultation concerning the activity or experiment. The treaty remains in force, signed by 102 member states. As of 2015, disaster strikes both sides in 1967. Both nations faced serious challenges that brought their programs to temporary halts. Both had been rushing at full speed toward the first piloted flights of Apollo and Soyuz, without paying due diligence to growing design and manufacturing problems. The results proved fatal to both pioneering crews. Charred interior of the Apollo 1 spacecraft after the fire that killed the first crew on January 27, 1967, the same day the US and USSR signed the Outer Space Treaty, the crew of the first manned Apollo mission, command pilot Virgil Gus Grissom, senior pilot Edward H. White, and pilot Roger Chaffee, were killed in a fire that swept through their spacecraft cabin during a ground test, less than a month before the planned February 21 launch. An investigative board determined the fire was probably caused by an electrical spark, and quickly grew out of control. Fed by the spacecraft's pure oxygen atmosphere, crew escape was made impossible by inability to open the plug door hatch cover against the greater than atmospheric internal pressure. The board also found design and construction flaws in the spacecraft, and procedural failings, including failure to appreciate the hazard of the pure oxygen atmosphere, as well as inadequate safety procedures. All these flaws had to be corrected over the next 22 months until the first piloted flight could be made. Mercury and Gemini veteran Grissom had been a favored choice of Dickey Slayton, NASA's director of flight crew operations, to make the first piloted landing. Commemorative plaque in the Fallen Astronaut sculpture left on the Moon in 1971 by the crew of Apollo 15 in memory of 14 deceased NASA astronauts and USSR cosmonauts on April 24, 1967. The single pilot of Soyuz 1, Vladimir Komarov, became the first in-flight spaceflight fatality. The mission was planned to be a three-day test, to include the first Soviet docking with an unpiloted Soyuz 2, but the mission was plagued with problems early on. Komarov's craft lacked sufficient electrical power because only one of two solar panels had deployed. Then the automatic attitude control system began malfunctioning and eventually failed completely, resulting in the craft spinning wildly. Komarov was able to stop the spin with the manual system, which was only partially effective. The flight controllers aborted his mission after only one day during the emergency re-entry. A fault in the landing parachute system caused the primary chute to fail, and the reserve chute became tangled with the drogue chute. Komarov was killed on impact. Fixing the spacecraft faults caused an 18-month delay before piloted Soyuz flights could resume onward to the Moon. The United States recovered from the Apollo 1 fire, fixing the fatal flaws in an improved version of the Block 2 command module. The U.S. proceeded with unpiloted test launches of the Saturn V launch vehicle Apollo 4 and Apollo 6 and the lunar module Apollo 5 during the latter half of 1967 and early 1968. Apollo 1's mission to check out the Apollo Command Service Module in Earth orbit was accomplished by Grissom's backup crew commanded by Walter Schirra on Apollo 7. Launched on October 11, 1968, the 11-day mission was a total success, as the spacecraft performed a virtually flawless mission, paving the way for the United States to continue with its lunar mission schedule.